So now we have Mrs. Soam and Puneet from two of the largest O&M third-party offering companies, and we would like your takes on probably how do you think technology will influence O&M, and how do you think that O&M is going to change over the next few years?
Thank you, Abhay. See, this is what happens to O&M. You are the last speaker to speak, right? And I know we have the last say in the industry. So we talk about technology, we talk about the best equipments, we talk about 25 years of life, and what do you have for O&M? Right? So it's very important for people to understand that O&M is much more than just cleaning the panels and cutting the grass. Right? That's the current belief in the industry. I think this has to definitely change. And we are from a cultural mindset wherein, you know, when you're in the traffic signal, instead of seeing the red, green light, we see if there's a policeman behind, right? Only then actually we make the move. It's not the light what matters, right? Which means monitoring is very, very important in O&M. So technology has to come in place. And, you know, we are glad. So we are actually managing more than 700 megawatts of solar power plants across India, and we have seen all kind of problems. So the best of the equipments are there, but the workmanship is, you know, is actually, I don't really comment on any particular issue. Then again, it comes to the tariff, the pricing, you know, because of that, somebody has to compromise somewhere. So I think as an O&M player, we got a real big role to play, and technology has to come in. So we are thinking of automizing things there too, right? As I mentioned earlier, the best of equipments, you know, you buy a BMW or Mercedes, it does need maintenance after years. First 3 years, you'll run your car fantastically, and you know, then it does need attention. And that is where we are focusing. We are, or actually, you know, people need to look into the trend of the generation. We need to look into preventive maintenance. So there are actually very good SCADA systems in the industry, but it is not just about on looking about the data. So what does the data speak? How does it really tell you where the problem is going to crop up? So analytics also very important. As you all know, you know, Abhay is also, you know, full-time into analytics. I think this is where we need to really head. O&M, again, just to repeat, it's much more than just looking after the plants. You know, the grass cutting and the module cleaning, that has got its own disadvantages. We have instances wherein we see the generation has dropped like anything. So the people who are cutting the grass, they have put their towels on the modules. So now what do you say for that, right? So there are a lot of challenges in the industry. I don't want to take too much of time on talking about that aspect. I think Mr. Puneet also has got a lot of things to say. So in summary, technology is needed for operation and maintenance of these plants if you want for the plant to perform for the next 25 years. Thank you, Abhay.
Thanks so much, Shekhar. I think I should have started the O&M session with a question of how many in the audience think O&M is about grass cutting and module cleaning. And then probably that point would have added on to the punch. But Puneet, the same question again to you. But just to get more precise, what do you think are the technologies available to the developers, asset owners sitting in the audience, that they can improve their performance?
Probably I'll have to break it down to the building blocks of the O&M a little bit. So contrary to what many of you in the audience would believe, the people sitting on the dais know very well that solar is a pretty simple technology when you compare it with a wind or a thermal particularly, or a hydro for that matter. Solar is pretty straightforward. A couple of panels, you put in series, you connect it to an inverter, inverter converts into AC power, step it up with the transformer and feed it to the grid, right? So when you come to O&M aspect of it, you'll think that there is some rocket science to it. Of course, it's just not about module cleaning and grass cutting. That much I can also testify. But that said, 70 to 80% of your cost is manpower, right? And typically, jaise the prices have gone down of bidding. So the rule of thumb has been that for every 1 rupee that you get in tariff, you can spend 1 crore rupees in EPC. And the rule is also that for every for whatever amount you're spending in EPC, 1% you can spend in O&M. So my problem is that my raw material cost is manpower, which is increasing every year by about 7%, 10%. And because talent is so scarce in solar industry, by actually 15%. And the cost of bidding is going down every year. Now it is at 2.44 rupees. By extension of that, the cost of EPC is 2.44 crores rupees per megawatt. And by extension of the 1% algorithm, my cost of O&M has magically got down to 2.44 lakhs. Per megawatt, right? So essentially what I'm trying to probably get at is that in order to achieve a better cost and still try to maintain somewhat semblance of quality in O&M, what we need to do is try to reduce the cost of manpower. Now, the cost of manpower cannot go down. I cannot reduce the inflation rates. What I can do is that I can reduce the number of people per megawatt that the industry employs. So earlier on, because of low cost of labor available in India, we used to be having 1:2, 1:3 ratio. That means 1 person for every 2 megawatt, 1 person for every 3 megawatts. Now, because of larger scale of maintenance and, as I was mentioning, better automation that is coming in place, we are having ratios of 1:4, 1:5. But still, we are far, far away from the ratios that is there used in the Europe, which is closer to 1:10. In fact, going to the extent of having unmanned plants completely. What is required or what are the shifts and technologies that will be required? One shift is very simple. Please, whichever plants you're building, get internet to your plants. You take that part in your plants and 50% of my problems are resolved, because the person who's sitting at the site is a technician who is earning about 20, 25,000 rupees salary. He doesn't have the brains of Abhay sir, who is the head of analytics, who is managing data of gigawatts of power plants. So do not expect him to be able to deliver. Please put a lease line on your plant, put internet, get remote monitoring, let somebody who's a professional sitting in the back end do the analytics and give you the output. A couple of other places where technology is going to play a major role. One is workflow automation. So we are talking about much more intelligent SCADA systems who just don't monitor the data, but also create work orders, also help in detection of what spare parts are being used when, what kind of time downtime is attributable to what kind of fault. Are you having firecrackers because of cable faults all the time, or is it the inverters fuses that are being blown away, so that you are able to do a little bit better spare management as well. What is going to also happen going forward, and this also speaks into Ritesh sir's point about quality of modules, is that we are also going to increasingly see the usage of drones for thermographic inspection of modules. There are trials that we have done in India. I'm sure there are others on the dais who have already played around the concept of using drones for different applications within solar. Thermographic inspection of panels is one of them. All of these, although sounds a little hi-fi, is basically about reduction of manpower on site. You put up an internet, there's this person who sits in front of the screen sipping his tea and seeing the SCADA system, doesn't have to sit over there. The person sitting at the office can manage 20 plants in parallel. Right? Similarly, if you're going to put a drone, there are typically 3 people that you use for thermographic inspections and IV curve testing at any point of time. On a 2 megawatt power plant, this will typically end up taking 3 days. You can do a 2 megawatt power plant with a drone in 8 minutes. Right? And there are some many such similar examples. Workflow automations can take out the whole point of reporting, detailed reporting, and work order management on your site, so on and so forth. Right? So to put it simply, all these technologies feed into reduction of manpower on site, and hence hopefully achieving the magical numbers that the bids allow us to put it at.
Thanks, Puneet. I really appreciate the answer, and thanks for bringing in data and analytics in your answer, because I think that is something that today the industry is learning about, and data is really important. I mean, whatever I do today is only because data is available. If data wasn't available, like Puneet mentioned, if there's no internet at site, there's no server which is storing the data, then tomorrow we don't know if the inverter was off for 10 minutes, 10 seconds, or 10 hours. It's at the end of the day, could CUF mila, it could be because of clouds, it could be because of other factors in the plant. And I think today developers are getting more and more conscious, but the whole anecdote about 2.44 lakhs per megawatt or 2.44 crores per megawatt which is being installed is important, because now we're hearing of developers who don't want to have string monitoring, don't want any communication to happen, etc., etc., etc. So everything that you do, to reduce cost will also reduce your performance. I mean, we were having a conversation just outside during the tea break, and we were talking about how O&M, whatever you're spending, is actually the only way you can get the maximum out of your asset. If you consider O&M as a cost, then at the end of the day, that 2, 3, 4, 10% more generation that you could probably achieve, you will miss out on if you don't have a good O&M partner. And I think the only thing I want to add on the technology piece is, yes, there is workflow automation which can help you. Drone thermography, like Puneet rightly said, 2 megawatt, 8 minutes is really simple. Plus, manpower intensive activities like weed removal, module cleaning. In the morning, I think Vivek was talking about robotic cleaning systems which are available. There are security systems which don't need anyone to be deployed at site. So there are a lot of things that are happening in the market, and I think we as the industry veterans should start adopting it, start using it, right? And I think we'll come back to Mr. Manta now, because all of this that we're talking about, technology, will add to cost. And we had an interesting session from PwC, but I think at the end of it, I was more scared of GST and what it's going to do. So I think as an ending note from all of this technology, I wanted it to be on a lighter note with Mr. Manta explaining exactly how will GST impact everything that we are trying to do. And let's say tomorrow we want to invest in technology and it increases my cost or capex by 10%. Is it really worthwhile? Will GST help me or not help me?
Before I talk about it, having listened to the technology, at least let me present my vision for next 3 to
Please.
5 years. I don't know who will do it. I'm not sure. All along we have been experiencing the reduction in cost. So I think when I started my solar journey, it was 17 crores per megawatt. Or 14 crores per megawatt, today it is 2.5 crores per megawatt. So I've seen all that. So what is happening is now O&M is basically to reduce the loss. So that is the objective of O&M. And what will happen, the technology, must be somebody doing it, is that at the row level, you will have the battery storage happening. Each row will be driven by an inverter. Even if there is a lot because of grid outage or for whatever reason, so you have a one-day backup there. So for a developer, loss of units is very important. So all along he has achieved his objective of cost reduction. But now, who is going to ensure that loss is not there? Whatever be the SCADA, the goal of the SCADA also to ensure to reduce the loss. So we are still into, okay, we find the problem, but it still takes in India, anywhere in the country, globe, that much time to rectify that.
Correct.
So what will happen is that at the row level, so maybe 40 modules row will become 90 rows modules. That's where tracker, I think, will still be important. Because those who have the apprehension of a tracker in terms of maintenance, this will offset that. And if that is taken care of, I'm sure there is no loss of energy. I'm sure it will happen in 3 years or maybe faster. In solar, you cannot predict anything. It may happen in next quarter also.
Yeah.
But that is the way. That is the way in terms of technology, 3 to 5 years. Anyway, now coming back to this, I got activated after seeing this sulfur from MNRE, which released on 18 July, and then they said 19 July by 12 o'clock you'll have to give the input on GST. I don't know how many of them have taken care of that. Today they're already in 27th. Huge, because according to them, there is nil effect, the circular. So which actually jolted me. So I thought I will go through the same thing and then line by line. I don't know whether UP will take it up. And they restricted the feedback has to come from National Solar Energy or Solar Power Developers. And they just gave 8 hours time. I don't know whether they have really taken care of it. So I think I'm going to keep voicing this until I get the another circular saying that it is addressed. Okay, coming back to it, PV modules, yes, there is a 5% impact on that, which was earlier zero. And GST has simplified the process. Earlier we had to keep the taxation zero, we had to do IC sales. And if you miss the IC sales, I think you get into the VAT regime, and then, okay, there are some who have lost it also. GST, in a way, has solved that problem. Now, and land costs, of course, I wonder. Civil and general works, they're considering before GST is 4%, which has not been the case. In a civil scenario, there are multiple things that different states follow. But otherwise, in a nutshell, it used to be 7% to 9%. Impact to the developer or EPC, because there are different scenario now, EPC one and developer one. And for a developer, it is 7 to 9%. For an EPC also, input cost is 7 to 9%. He may charge tomorrow 5%. Whether he'll pass on the benefit or not, we don't know, EPCs. So now it is 18%. So the damage of 9% happening at the input cost level. So the input cost increase is common for whether EPC or a developer. That doesn't change. For them, it is saying nil effect. And mounting structure, similarly, 18% today. Earlier, it used to be depending on the transaction, either 2% CAGR or 5% VAT. So now it is 18%. That doesn't change. Whether it is whether you get it from other state or within the state, 18%. So there is a net impact for a developer purchase, it is 18%. For an EPC, it is 13%. Because he may pass on the benefit of 5% if he is getting input credit of 5%. And power conditioning unit, which is nothing but inverter, used to be zero. If you buy from Bangalore, it is used to be zero. That means for an inverter, you don't pay any excise duty and taxation, sales tax, or VAT, everything is zero. Now it is 18%. And for a developer, 18%. For an EPC, it is 13%, I would say. He may pass on the benefit of 5%. I'm assuming he will pass on the benefit in the competitive environment. And similarly, evacuation cost up to interconnection point, cables, transformer, and all this is, today it is now 18%. For ST level. For LT level certain components, it is 28%. Maybe AC DB, DC DB and all that stuff could be 28%. In net effect, there is again a 13% to 15% increase at the input cost level. That is what they have addressed. So if you look at the module level 5% and the rest of the components put together, in my opinion, minimum is 13%. Maximum could be even 25%. And you translate that into money terms, in my opinion, it is around 25 lakhs, 5 lakh, 10 lakhs per module at the current price straight away, and for rest of them put together could be 10 to 15 lakhs. So there's an impact per megawatt, 20 lakhs. So I don't know who will take care of it. At a 2.44 guy cannot do it at 2.44 if GST is not addressed. No, 244, you mean tariff or a cost?
The tariff, the IPP which is sustainable with this GST.
Yes. Yes, correct, 20 lakhs.
Correct.
I agree. Yeah. I am agreeing. So 2.44 guy cannot do it, I am saying straight away. Who will change it? It is a difficult scenario to change it. Having bid,
I think that 2.44, when the bidding happened was, again, one of them was an Indian player, but the other was using, I am quite sure, foreign funding. So the IRR for both of them are completely different.
Yes.
Look, if we go by that calculation of every rupee and every crore and every thing, then 20 lakhs means 20 paise. 20 paise is the impact on the tariff.
There is a benchmark for a tariff to 20 paise.
Correct.
I can give you that. It is 1.1 roughly. If a cost is 2.5 crores, tariff has to be 1.1.
So I would like to answer your question. I think I've got a gist of what you're saying. So CERC releases a benchmark capex cost every year. But unfortunately, if you see every bid, it has beat that hollow. Every bid has beat that benchmark tariff hollow or benchmark capex hollow. Why is that happening? Two, three reasons why I would say, and the panel can add many more, I'm sure. The first one is, the expectation of IRR is something that used to be at, let's say, this level, and it's come down. So people are ready to take a cut on their IRR expectation. Secondly, the prediction or the forecasting that people are doing at the rate at which the module prices will fall, that's again an assumption which is taken at the bidding stage. People assume that I'll buy it at this rate and this is what I'll achieve. The third thing is I will also give it a little bit of benefit to the learning curve and what we've experienced in the last 5 years. So consistently, like in the morning we had another session where we were talking about how people thought 5 rupees, it's a crazy tariff. 4 rupees, crazy tariff. 3.5, crazy tariff. But every time, if you ask the developers who are running those plants, they're happy with it. In fact, the person who's probably running it at a 4.4 is extremely happy with it. So that's my take on your question, that there cannot be a sustainable level or an industry average. It's changing extremely fast, and it's not just in India. The same thing is happening across the globe, and we can add a few more viewpoints on the answer that you're looking for.
I think right. It's no longer.
Otherwise, it doesn't make sense at all. IRR is linked to your flows, inflows that will happen.
Correct.
The project.
Correct.
Okay. Unless and until your payback goes up and you're willing to actually have that sort of a risk exposure, this entire discussion, unless it is integrated and understood by all the partners concerned, is actually a nonsense discussion.
Now, simple submission to you. There's already 15 gigawatt of installations have happened at different tariff levels. All of them achieved their IRR in less than predicted.
Yes,
that's right.
That's
it, simple message.
Which
one?
They have been overpriced in bidding.
No.
They expect
while bidding, they bid with available inputs for a certain IRR. But thanks to solar industry, the price have been dropping. Okay, faster than everybody anticipated, even developers anticipated when they bid it. So they achieved the IRRs. If they anticipated 5 years IRR, they would have achieved in 3 years. I'm just giving you a simple example. So don't ever think that even a single developer has lost it today. First time I'm saying in this forum, in all my earlier speeches, I always used to say that today with this GST, 2.44 guy cannot do it.
Yes. Yeah. See, it's just no longer about technology. If you look at solar, it's now a financial game.
It's a financial game.
It's no longer about technology. Technology is the guys who are maybe selling technology like us, who are focused on quality. But at the really top echelons, it's just a financial game. So this is my budget. This is my IRR. This is how you need to fit in. I don't care what you fit in. My returns need to come in 6 months.
Yeah.
My payoffs need starting in 6 months. So then the engineer has nothing, he can't do anything. If the engineer says no, he gets sacked. Another engineer comes in who does what he's told to do. So that's how it works, right? So the pressure comes from top. That's how it is. So end of the day, we have to acknowledge that. But then that thing needs to be pushed up a little more rather than just accepting everything. Like even the vendors accept. And the reason why the top guys have gotten away with it is because China has been able to drop so badly.
Yeah.
I mean the pricing, but if that had in the middle, if you had seen a variation where it went high, then the whole thing would have stalled. But we've been very, very fortunate. But how long will that fortunate continue is a question mark.
Mr. Manta, thanks. Your
but the narrative will not work because what we're talking about is where the entire money and the inflows move to the O&M guy. You have basically ensured that your installation is actually going to fail within a certain time frame. So unless and until there's a proactive maintenance schedule that is or there is a repair installation that comes to come at the O&M stage, even if the sacking of the engineer is not going to help because you're going to pay the O&M guy for whatever that you're not listening to the engineer in between. As simple as that.
Right.
No,
I love the energy you bring to this room at 6 in the evening. I really appreciate that.
One more submission is solar is very simple. That's how today you educate one person, next time he will not come to you, he will do it himself. Okay. So it is that simple. It is that simple. And we have already, I think, finished 7 years, 5 years. And maybe out of 100 installations, one or two only have problems. Rest of them do not have problems.
Yeah.
O&M is still at the back seat because all of them are performing well. But for grass cutting and module cleaning. Okay, so don't think that solar is complicated. As of now, whoever has entered solar, at the best guys, there are, I think, fortune, exalted stars in their horoscope, they're enjoying.